Okay, we talked about this 90-minute co-host with Cheap Trick, and we talked about this brand new record. A lot of guitarists are known for skills. You're also known for skills and the collection. Okay, here's just one of, how many guitars do you own?
I've owned a couple hundred during the, or a couple thousand during our career, in my career, but right now I'm down to about 200, but I'm looking for some new ones. Yeah, I'm collecting a lot of cool stuff, sold some stuff to Paul McCartney, Dave Edmonds, bought some guitars here in Canada. I'm always looking for cool stuff.
Why would you need a guitar that has five necks on it, though?
Well, we needed some space to cover part of the front of our new album cover, so I had him add four necks to it.
Each neck has its own little person.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We carry magic crystals inside the neck, which has given us the eternal, some eternal youth through psycho-cybernetics.
Do you play all five in the course of a night, all five necks?
Yes, I do. As a matter of fact, I use it on one song and I play all five necks, so you have to watch close.
You've been around for 20 years. A lot of you have string of hits. Now, there's also been a couple of periods where no matter what you released, there were lean periods in there. Now, what does a band go through when this kind of stage is happening? Do you blame yourself? Do you blame
boxes,
radio?
Boxes
do you blame?
Of Kleenex, lots of crying. Nah, we did nothing.
Only hand praying.
Nothing we can do about it, so we just go out and I've always said, if we waited around for a hit song or a hit record to go tour, we'd never tour, you know, because with all the tunes we've put out and all the albums we've put out, you know, we've had more flops than successes. Well, guess what? We've also made some cool records through the years, and we're lucky enough that we'll get to continue and make some more records. That's a good deal.
I agree. But just the nature of the business, rock and roll fans are notoriously fickle. And it must be nice that you've been around for so long and have cultivated a solid, hardcore fan base that have seen you through it.
There's always something good on it, even though the record might flop. You know, not every song we do is great. But we've, like you said, created a fan base in the early years that's held on to our band and seen us through rough times. What more could you ask for?
If I wasn't in the band Cheap Trick, I'd be a fan of the band.
Well, most artists speak of a sense of purging that happens when they write their autobiography. I've heard it said it's almost like a therapy to them. Was there a sense of that at all? No?
None. The only thing I got with that is, damn, that woman is still alive. She should have been dead years ago. That's the only thing I got out of that. It's just I was amazed. Because you have to read the final all together in a galley form. And that's page one, you know, real fast, one page. So I read the whole thing and went, God, she's alive. That's just amazing. But that's it. That's the only thing that amazed me about any of it.
It surprised you that you were still here.
Yeah.
When a lot of your contemporaries didn't make it.
Yeah. And the way I live my life, it's like, it's always just this side of a bullet, almost. I mean, you know, it's just amazing. So I'm happy to be here, but I'm surprised, too.
Any idea, have you ever given any thought to why a lot of your contemporaries are not here and you still are?
No, because if you get into the cosmic stuff, there's a reason you're supposed to be. I mean, you know, I can get nuts with that. Okay, what's the reason? The only thing I can figure out is you do what's in front of you and keep on going. You keep trying to improve a little bit and do what's in front of you. Do what you want to do, what you're good at. Like if your parents want you to be a lawyer and you're working for much more, the hell with them. If you like what you're doing. And very often people do what they don't want to do because they're pleasing a bunch of other people, they're pleasing their husband, they're pleasing their parents, something, whatever it is. And that isn't going to work for very long, it's going to make you nuts. So the only thing I can think of is do what you like to do and what you can do well, and don't worry about why. But then, you know, I get in a lot of trouble with that kind of philosophy.
I was reading an article from the London Telegraph.
Uh-huh.
A reporter tailed you for a night of clubbing. You talked about you can't really do anything without the paparazzi being there.
Well, especially in London.
I remember reading the article and walking away thinking, despite that, it still must be nice to be Mick Jagger.
Some of the times it is.
Yeah.
But most of the time, you've got to take the rough with the smooth. You know, there's ups and downs in everyone's life. The disadvantage, like you're talking about, being someone going out, you can't really be private very much.
You know?
Yeah, I don't really mind that much. You know, if you don't want to get into that, then don't go out. You know, I know that if I go out, then maybe someone's going to write about what I'm doing. So if I, you know, if I don't want to be written about, then don't go out. It's like simple as that. Because some people in show business take that to the nth degree and they just stay at home or they or they become reclusive, you know, which is not really very healthy, I don't think. And so you've got to balance it out.
You have done it really well in that you are public enough that you're not a hermit, but there has always been a mystique.
Yeah.
About Mick.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a balancing act, you know. I don't like to be over-cultivating mystique either, you know. I'm not really into myth-making. It's not really my thing to make myths. I don't think it's really... I think it's a lot of bullshit, really.
Mick Jagger still gets a cold.
Sure do.
The fame and being in a rock band is great for about 10 minutes, and then the rest of it is a hell that people don't see.
Well, I was very proud. I was 31 years in that band, you know, and I was very proud of everything we achieved. But I didn't want to go on anymore because we weren't heading for new challenges. We'd done it all, and it was just repetitive, just for a whole bunch of money. That's all it was. And I didn't want to repeat myself for the next 10 years just to get a bunch of money in my bank account. Not that my bank account didn't need it, because I didn't write the songs, but I thought there were other things to do in my life, so I did other things.
Did you miss playing? Did you miss the audience? Because you said you never touched the bass for about 2 years, leaving the Stones.
No, not at all. No, I just got on with other things, got married and did many other things, you know, that interest me. And then I thought, try some music, but I'll do it different. Do something, whatever grabs my fancy. And that's what I did. And when I cut an album with the Stones, it was 6 months in Toronto or 6 months in Munich or Amsterdam or something, and then 3 months mixing. With this band, I did that album, double bill, 24 tracks, high quality music, 8 days. We cut 22 tracks in 8 days. I had a couple of tracks left. We did some overdubs, it was finished. That's the difference. I don't want to be 6 months in a studio in Amsterdam, away from my family anymore, when I can do it in 8 days with the Rhythm Kings and produce high quality music of a variety and really enjoy it.
Well, 6 months in Amsterdam would kill you, period.
Oh, it's not a bad town. But,
not
but
for 6 months, though.
But I don't like to be away from home that long. And I wouldn't do it unless this band had something really special about it.
What might surprise some people is that it's coming from someone who is an icon, who is a media icon,
really,
to admit this.
Yeah, but, I mean, who better to say that fame and fortune and success and beauty doesn't bring you happiness than somebody who's been through all of those things? Mm-hmm. It's not, you know, it's not an easy thing to say because, you know, I spent the last 20 years, you know, working my butt off and, you know, having a certain amount of values or certain kinds of values and, you know, slowly, you know, my evolution really started when I had children, you know, but like starting, you know, you start, your priorities change, you start to look at life from a different perspective. And also I'm really waking up to what's going on in the world around me and not being so like, my career, you know what I mean? And I feel like I've had the Band-Aid ripped off and I'm looking at everything that I valued, but also what everybody else values and saying, no, wait a minute. Something wrong here because we're living in a world that is just full of chaos and suffering and pain. So, you know, on the one hand, we have all this great stuff happening, you know, all this success, all this beauty, all this glamour, but then what's really going on behind the pretty picture? You know, a lot of unhappy people. So maybe we're all focusing a little bit too much on the wrong things.
There's a few sentiments you express in different ways on the record, along the lines of that.
Right.
And even in American Life, there is a reference to not caring anymore, to wanting to be on top, mm-hmm. I think.
Not caring about, you know, having, you know, seeing myself as number one. Like, you know, I've obviously grown up very, you know, in this business, very competitive, you know, and that's been part of my drive, you know. You know, I will not stop, I will not shut up, you know, whatever. And I've always had this kind of strange, unexplainable drive. But, no, I don't care about, like I said, I don't care about being perceived as being on top, because that's all an illusion anyways. Because let's face it, the real heroes of the world are the people that nobody knows about, uh-huh. You know. The people that are, you know, the school teachers, the, you know, the spiritual leaders, the you know, writers, you know, there are so many people that are doing great things for the world and, you know, in terms of, you know, research scientists, and you know, there's so many unsung heroes that people don't even know about. So being perceived as being on top, you know, is a total illusion. And so, do I care about that anymore? No. But what do I care about? What I care about is that I can do what I can to make the world a better place.
And your contribution is, do you agree with it that it's entertainment and that it's not necessarily frivolous but needed?
Well, I hope it isn't frivolous. I mean, I think I've gone past the idea of entertaining just for the sake of making people forget. I want it to make people remember. Mm. And I'd like to think that it's a worthwhile contribution. I hope so.
How odd is it for you to express your individuality in certain ways like that, and to look out and see 10,000 people copying you, copying your sense of individuality? It must seem bizarre.
Oh, you mean in the beginning?
Yeah.
Well, in the beginning, I didn't know what to think. I thought that, you know, I never saw a girl screaming over a woman, you know, so I thought, I didn't know what they thought about that, and I didn't know what to make of it either, and then I realized later it was just kind of a hero thing, and I thought that it was good, and then I started to remember all my heroes, that sometimes they would say things that were very helpful to me, and that if you had the opportunity and the platform to always remember that, if you really share your experience honestly, than someone else who may be experiencing that, because we all have that human condition, is it's a great way to contribute. Mm-hmm. I think the most important thing for me was always to evaluate, why did I come to this planet? What am I doing here on Earth? What is my purpose? Why am I singing music? And why do we make music? Music, it changes the vibration of things, and it makes it lighter, and it makes it better. And for me, and I think my band too, you're always striving to go to the zone, to that place where you're either much more of what you ever thought you could be, or somebody else. You know, I would like to think it's much more of who, yeah, hoped you could be.
Yeah.
But you don't know how the heck, and it's better not to think about it, because once you start thinking, and once you got that eye looking at you from the inside out, it's over.
I love that place. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But that's what you feel like when you listen to music and you really get into it and you lose yourself. Even in its purest form, like air guitar or air drums or, mm-hmm. you know, whatever. Music and the arts, they really change the vibration of things when it gets real dense. I think it's real important for people to make music. There are many levels of success.